So what if I could give you three very simple architectural visualization tricks that would elevate your work instantly? It's not AI and it doesn't take any specific knowledge. These are moves that I started using somewhat recently, I would say. I mean, I got them from other areas and then adapted to architectural visualization. So I'm pretty sure you don't know all of them, but if you do, please let me know in the comments below because they are very specific. So grab any 3D model to follow along and test these tips yourself. And well, if you'd like to use the same project that I have right here, I'll leave a link in the video description as always. But these tips work with pretty much any visualization workflow. All right, I'm gonna be using DE5, but they work with Lumion, FinMotion, Corona, V-Ray, really any, as long as you have a render engine, and obviously Photoshop, because we're gonna be doing post-production with Photoshop. And I'm happy to say that this video is sponsored by Poliigon. I've been using them for years already, and now having their support here on the channel means a lot. I'll talk more about them in a bit, but for now, let's dive into tip number one. It's getting easier and easier to handle massive areas of vegetation nowadays, right? I mean, with ready-to-use libraries, with plants and trees, I mean, the scatter tool and everything already set up for us. But I don't know if you guys noticed, 3D vegetation can often look a little too flat, too even, you know, often even a bit too green, well, for my taste at least. So there are a few things that I always do to try to give the natural elements a little bit more of a realistic look. First, I always play with the green and yellow hue to get different results, something that sometimes it's not easy to tweak in a render engine, but in Photoshop it's super fast. And this can be done with the hue and saturation adjustment layer, like this. Or even a selective color adjustment layer. This is a little bit more specific, and a little bit, maybe a bit advanced, but it's also possible. Or even my preferred method, which is inside the camera raw filter for even more control. And honestly, I always lower the saturation a little bit. I mean, it's just that usually it comes too vibrant. Now there's something subtle, but even more powerful that you can do with your vegetation, which is actually the specific trick that I wanted to show you in this step. I mean, handling vegetation in general, but this specific trick that I started using recently. In recent versions of Photoshop, we now got this new slider that can widen the range of a color hue you've got in your image. I usually do this step at the very end of a post-production workflow in Photoshop when it's actually time to work in the camera raw filter, which is something that I always do. So in here, under the color mixer, you now have this somewhat new tab called point color, but that's not it. It's this even newer slider called variance, exactly what we need. And if you color pick a green from your image, so try to pick something that feels more the medium green that you have with your vegetation. And now if we move the slider here to the right, you're now adding variance to this hue, grabbing more of the color spectrum in a sense, how nature really behaves, right? Nothing in nature is just really one hue of green. It's a subtle adjustment here. I mean, nothing too crazy, but it just takes a little bit of that odd flat green out of the rendering, making it more realistic. For me, now it's a vital part for all of the visuals I create, especially these that have a lot of vegetation. And obviously, not just the post-production, but I also make sure that I have a bit of variation in terms of the assets I use. I mean, in this one, it made sense to have these sort of yellowish trees in this park scene that I'm creating, but think about how nature behaves. And as I always say, it's about combining all of these small things that will get your visuals to a unique result. By the way, if you'd like to learn how to get results like these, you might want to check out our D5 Render Visualizing Architecture course, where I'll take you from beginner to advanced in D5 Render and post-production in Photoshop. It's a very complete course that has been getting amazing reviews from our students. I'll leave a link in the video description. Now on to tip number two, and this one is specifically about materials. If you work in an architecture firm, interior design, landscape, or even in the urban design field, you know that architectural visualization renderings isn't your primary focus. You will most likely be using real-time engines like TwinMotion, D5, Lumion, or Enscape. Really, for an architecture practice, there's no reason to go into 3ds Max with Corona or even V-Ray, or then Blender with Cycles. I mean, if you want to, sure, go ahead, but I'm saying that it's way too advanced for your needs. These are more for CGI artists and studios that are primarily focused on archviz, and these over here are more for professionals and designers looking to get high quality results without spending days or even weeks for a couple of images. Still, we can learn from these advanced workflows. For example, and here's the specific trick, while using these real-time engines, take advantage of Photoshop to have better control over material maps. adjusting values, and adding imperfections. For this step, you will definitely need high quality materials, and one of my go-to websites has always been Poliigon. It's an insane library of PBR materials and assets. There's so much quality and so many options to choose from. And as I said, I've been using them for years, and I can even show you proof with this purchase history here. Their website is clean and easy to navigate, but they now also have a very handy SketchUp extension that helps you import all of their assets, especially if you use V-Ray, because it comes all set up for you, all render ready. You can log in here with your account, and then you have the entire library right inside SketchUp. Same categories as their website, but faster and more convenient. And even though I'm working with D5 render right now, I find it really helpful to just use the plugin to grab materials quickly. For example, I'll search for concrete board form, like this one right here, and then click on the download button. And the plugin downloads all of the necessary maps locally. From here, it's all V-Ray ready, but for all of the other engines, you can take advantage of this faster workflow by having access to this folder structure that gets created. And then inside D5, for example, and this works for any other render engine, I can quickly assign the maps to the designated slots to make this PBR material look realistic. And this workflow is really fast, just having the plugin, having the folder structure created for me, and just quickly plugging in. Now the model section comes as proxy versions, so that means that they are light on SketchUp and optimized for smooth performance while still being render ready for V-Ray. And then if you're using another engine like D5, you can simply go here to the website and download the FBX file directly. And from here, you're good to go. Just assign the materials and maps and it will work perfectly here too. Poliigon is honestly a must for anyone doing architectural visualization. And what I like the most about them is that they are very architecture focused. Their textures just fit for this type of work. So go to poliigon.com and start with the free materials and models. And then when you're ready to upgrade, and trust me, you will be, just use my link in the video description to get 10% off your subscription. Well, plus by using my link directly, supports this channel and helps me make more content like this one. So back to the tip here. What I was saying is that with a roughness map, which is a map that controls how shiny or matte the material is, something that comes with a PBR material from Poliigon, we then can grab a surface imperfection map, which also needs to be seamless for this to work, all right? And I love these from Poliigon here. I've always been using this, these maps right here. There's also free options. You can check it out. Test it and see if you like them. And then in Photoshop, I can combine them both. So the roughness map and the imperfection map. And since I've picked both in 4K right here, I can just drop the imperfection on top of the roughness and just change the blend mode to multiply here, since we have a white background and we want to get rid of that. So now they're combined, and this means that wherever it's black, it gets shinier, revealing smudges. And you can do this with more than one layer of imperfection if you want to combine them, like adding scratches, for example. But this time, the inverse, we're going to be using the screen blend mode to review only the white pixels. And then in this case, since it's a roughness map, the white pixels means that there's no reflection, no shininess. It's all very rough wherever there's scratches. And just go easy here, right? Don't overdo it. Something very subtle usually works best. You can even use a mask to choose where they show up. And then obviously save as a copy so that you don't ruin the original map in case you want to revert back the changes or do variations and try experiment with different results. And you can even do this with the specular map if available. Sometimes it comes with it, sometimes it doesn't. And then when you add these new maps to the engine, in my case here, D5, again, it can be any render engine as long as you're adding to the roughness slot, for example, you will get a used texture that feels a little bit more realistic, right? Since surfaces in the real world tend to get scratched, smudged, and worn. This is not a mandatory step for materials. It's something that I use very rarely, only when I need to give a finish that extra touch, often the flooring or a tabletop finish when it's closer to the camera. Don't overdo this. You don't need to do it for every surface, all right? And I know that with Corona and cycles, you have a lot more control and you can properly blend that with nodes and much more advanced, and you can do that in a non-repeating way. But I'm showing you the essence here on how these imperfections work and how they can be explored with any engine, even the simpler ones It's a simple trick that can help you elevate your visualization workflow. And well, before we move on to tip number three, the same thinking using Photoshop can be applied to refining a map to your needs. Say that you liked a finish, but needed to be a bit more glossy or have shinier spots. You can use, say, a levels adjustment to increase the contrast, intensifying more of its appearance, or even reducing the lightness altogether to make the entire surface more glossy. I mean, you do have these sliders in the render engine to control how much you want to use it, but having Photoshop gives you even more control. You just got to remember how the values work, right? White and black. So in a roughness map, black means very shiny, a very smooth and glossy surface, and white, so value of one, means very dull, totally rough. So enough about this very specific one. Let me talk about tip number three. This one I believe I saw in a reel or a short, and I'm not being able to find the video again to credit the author. It was a Blender trick, I believe, but once I watched it, I knew I could adapt to other engines. I found other supporting material for the effect I'm about to show you. It's called a shadow fringe. You can check out in the video description if you're interested. But here how it goes. I mean, in an archviz workflow, we either use a default sun to light up our scene or an HDRI, right? But often in both occasions, we get a very 3D-like shadow, meaning there's no depth or even distortion on it. Pixar movies often exaggerate a warm, almost burnt shadow fringe to make a scene feel more lively or cozy. And we can get this idea and replicate, obviously, with something a lot more subtle, but that helps to break up a bit of that 3D richness that we get in engines like D5, Lumion, Twinmotion, and Enscape. What you're going to do is this. Along with the HDRI that you're using, so I'm using this one right here, turn on a second sun if you have the option. I mean, more advanced engines, you can do that, but I know that with D5, you also can. And then instead of making it follow the HDRI, make it custom, and then you're going to align them both manually. Yes, again, and this is, it can be hard and can be tricky, but once you do it, and here's the specific trick that I'm about to show you, shift the angle just a tiny bit so that you create a shadow fringe, something very, very subtle here. And in the second sun, you might want to explore a much, much warmer temperature. I mean, if you're going for that sunrise or sunset look, of course, or even slightly more neutral for a typical day scene, but I tend to use more of this shadow fringe in either sunset or sunrise. It's all about testing and feeling how it looks. I couldn't really give you like specific values and numbers so that you can replicate. It always varies depending on the scene. Sometimes it's the altitude that you need to shift a bit so that that shadow fringe happens at the edge, like at the end. Sometimes it's the azimuth so that the shadow just has a shadow fringe on all of the length. Also play with the sun disk radius, which makes the shadow generated from the sun even softer. It just helps with the overall look. And then, well, you can go from this to this. Amazing, right? Again, it's just a subtle change like with the other tips we're seeing, but combining all of these subtle tips and obviously the core principles of architectural visualization, you can get results like these. And this one here is my favorite of the batch. There's this extra layer of storytelling that's something that you don't see very often. Thanks again to Poliigon for sponsoring this video. Don't forget to subscribe to not miss future tips and tricks. And if you'd like to learn more about the core principles I just mentioned, you might want to check out this video right here. I'll see you there.